the universe, dark memory, and you. The newest findings in physics can be important without affecting anyone's daily life. But there has been some recent speculation that goes to the very heart of human existence. The speculation revolves around the proposition that the universe may have a memory. There is talk about very technical things like gravitational memory and black hole memory that seem far removed from our daily lives. Human interest enters, however, when you think about the possibility that we all live in a conscious universe. Memory, after all, is being part of being conscious. But both are invisible and, in a sense, impossible to measure. You might think that cosmic memory is dark, meaning that it is out of sight but hugely powerful nevertheless. The discovery of so-called dark matter, dark energy, caused the standard model of the universe to, in a sense, implode. It had to be revised. The very existence of stars and galaxies might depend on dark matter and dark energy. Yet both are invisible and impossible to measure directly. They are both knowable by what we do, such as causing galaxies to accelerate away from each other in deep space. What if cosmic memory is not only dark, but just as powerful? This isn't fanciful, mystical, or New Age thinking. In each of us, consciousness is known subjectively. I know that I am conscious. That's so obvious, it doesn't need to be stated. Of course, when we talk about our minds all the time, it is a crucial part of being human. But to a scientist, consciousness isn't real until brain functions are looked at, which can be measured on a scan and prove that mental activity is taking place. So what kind of activity makes it possible that the universe remembers events? Especially, how can we know if it remembers human beings? There are several enticing clues. First, evolution. The fact that the universe evolved to produce life on Earth seems purposeful. This notion can even give rise to the so-called anthropic principle, which states that the universe we see and know is perfectly set up to produce life on Earth, and human DNA. Our DNA is the most single complex thing known in creation. Somehow, the universe remembered what it was aiming at for 9 billion years before the Earth began to coalesce as an infant planet. Second is when we look at species. Once evolution began on Earth, creatures evolve as if with a goal in mind. The most primitive ancestor of the horse, for example, was a small mammal with no resemblance to a modern horse. Yet step by step, the modern horse evolved, exhibiting thousands of characteristics that make it a horse, as we see it. How could they all combine through the pure chance of random genetic mutations? Every species we see has become specifically what it is through intricate, specialized genetic templates. A third thing to consider is human difference. Modern Homo sapiens has been around for about 100,000 years. Yet, it is only 30,000 years that Asians look like Asians, Africans like Africans, Europeans like Europeans. That's less than 1% of the time it takes for animal species to become a specific. Random selection seems inadequate to describe the hyperspeed of evolution. Psychological choices is just as unlikely. If mutations are as random as Darwinian theory insists, then only one Asian-looking, African-looking, or European-looking would be born in, say, 10,000 years or more. Do we really believe that out of 10,000 babies, a society picked the one that was different to the model for the entire race? I don't think so. Another thing to consider. The incredibly useful brain. The brain of Homo sapiens is human because of the development of the higher brain or cerebrum. Thanks to the higher brain, every aspect of civilization, including art, music, law, science, technology and mathematics were made possible. Yet the first Homo sapiens used their brains for none of these things. So why did the higher brain appear at least 70 to 80,000 years before civilization advanced on the scene? And then let's also consider predispositions. Every mother sees the nascent personality of a child early on, usually before age 1. By age 5, some children inexplicably become child prodigies at music or math. No one can explain how predispositions arise. Genetics is the default explanation. But when you were born, your genes exhibited 100,000 differences from your parents' genes. These are supposed to be random mutations. Yet somehow, a child who can play the violin at a professional level at age 6 needs an advanced brain, motor coordination, musical pitch, and musical talent that defy explanation by pointing to genes, which after all are basically maps for making proteins. Was Mozart a luck combination of proteins? And then also let's consider reincarnation. Child prodigies are about as far as science is willing to go when it comes to unusual and extreme populations. But Eastern spiritual traditions and certain passages in the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament testify to a belief in reincarnation. Some children, typically between the ages of 5 and 8, can remember their past lives. Over 200 such cases have been strictly and carefully documented. Are we to believe that this is a genetic trait? Such children can take researchers to the place where they lived in a past life, and almost all can visualize how they died. Also, let's consider karma. The doctrine of karma is a doctrine of cause and effect, a mechanistic scheme of as you sow, so shall you reap. For this to work out, some actions are not linked to their consequences until perhaps another lifetime, which of course is totally unacceptable to modern Western science. Yet, without accepting or denying the doctrine of karma, what's intriguing is that only an invisible form of memory could keep track of the actions being taken at a given instant. Could all of these phenomena, all taken together, point to a dark memory in the universe? A mainstream scientist would flatly say no, which involves coming up with better explanations that are so far not available. The usual attitude is simply to ignore the whole business. But as a single explanation could already exist, and that single explanation in Sanskrit is called Chitakash, a Sanskrit term for consciousness space, where dark memory is mingled with all other aspects of mind. After all, we can't even explain what a thought is, where it comes from, or what the next thought will be. Chitakash is creative. Its prime purpose is to oversee the evolution of mind. On this path, Chitakash remembers the collective traits that make us most human. Love, compassion, empathy, insight, intuition, discovery, self-awareness, and personal growth. No one invented those things. They are innate in us, thanks to dark memory. As always, there's much more to say on the subject, but the takeaway is that we need a modern version of Chitakash that allows for an understanding of the dark memory in such a way that it suits our modern worldview. The first step is to look at everything that needs explaining. Only then can possible answers be weighed. I would love feedback on this from you, because if you do enjoy this kind of insight on audio, then I'll be happy to do it every week. Thank you, my friends.